Even a hurricane and 11 tornadoes weren't going to keep me from saying goodbye to Father Bruce.
So I'm here on the train, the MARC train, pulling into Union Station. I was lucky to get a flight on my favorite airline to get me to Baltimore. And now I'm getting into Washington, and I'll go from Union Station to my hotel, drop off my luggage, and then go over to the church so I can be there for Compline before the service tomorrow. So far, smooth trip. I'm just grateful that I'm able to be here.
Ladies and gentlemen, final stop. In the DC Union Station, once again, now coming into our final station stop. We'll open on the left side, watch your step. There will be a gap between train and station platform. If you start to step off the train, make sure you have all first belongings looking over there, look at your wife, seats next to you. Please do not leave anything behind on the train. Once again, this is our final station stop, Washington, DC Union Station. On behalf of the Kentucky crew members and the mayor of the department of transportation, we'd like to thank you for choosing MARC as your public transportation. Enjoy your night and weekend. Once again, Washington, D.C. Now, Rob.
So I'm here in Metro Station, figuring out where I go next and how to get to my hotel. So I'm here in my hotel at the Hamilton, very lovely room, simple but all I need, and I got upgraded to a better view, so I appreciate that, but I'm going to get freshened up and head on over to the church.
Very touching. The brothers sit vigil. Someone stays with him all night.
Good morning. I'm back at St. Dominic's. There'll be some prayers this morning. The brothers sat with Bruce all night, reading Psalms and praying. And then this morning we'll say some final prayers, and they'll close the casket, and then we'll move into the funeral.
Entering the There's the door. Early on, the nurse inquired how I had gotten to Rome. I replied, unfortunately, I entered you well. From then on, Bruce became my ever patient spiritual director and friend. In all the ups and downs, dodges and detours of my vocational discernment, eventually helping me to realize a call within a call to religious life. Moments like this remind us we are not our own achievement. We are neither sole author nor architect of our accomplishments, but collaborators in others' tireless, patient investment in us. Our family and friends, priests and religious, the myriad mentors whose fidelity reminds us that our vindicator indeed lives, just as Job tells us today. Bruce met his own mentor, diocesan priest Father John Toole, at age 11, while playing the piano for an 8th grade graduation. He was self-taught at 5 years of age. A rabbi, Protestant minister, and Catholic priest spoke that day. I remember what the minister said, as we called. When we are desperate, we can call on God. And what the rabbi said, have a sacred regard for all human beings. He didn't remember a thing, the Catholic priest said. Though he was deeply struck by his presence, marked by kindness, warmth, and a genuinely friendly, accepting attitude. That's what drew me, Bruce explained, a kid raised with a Jewish mother and a Protestant father, to look deeper into the Catholic faith. That priest presence. Preaching by mere presence, a lesson for all us preachers today. 5 years later, Father Toole welcomed Bruce into the Catholic faith at age 16. At age 26, Bruce would receive a copy of Father Oldschool's recommendation for his application to the Order of Preachers. And although he wanted to be a lawyer, since working as a college stock boy in the library of the New York Young Lawyers Association, Bruce's inmost being was now consumed with a new longing, to echo Job in our first reading. What was true of his mentor was true of Bruce. He always preached first by his presence, kind, gentle, patient, inquisitive about you, the person. Whether Roman professor, retreat director at Dover, parish pastor and preacher, friend or relative, Brother Friars drinking 8 years with Parkinson's, before he preached with his words, Bruce preached with his presence. And yet, Bruce was a man of words. One driven by the same ardent desire of Job to have his words of belief written down, inscribed in a record, cut in rock forever, never for his own ego, but as the down payment he owed on the debt he owed to the truth, not an ideal, but the person of Jesus Christ he had discovered. He owed the preached word, the taught word, the written word, the pastoral word, through his life and ministry as one of a skilled weaver, crossing the threads of truth over and under each other, creating a beautiful tapestry of God, the living vindicator. We will see not with another's eyes, but one day with our own. Bruce not only genuinely longed for that moment himself, especially in these last months, but longed to help others to see that brilliant ultimate purpose of the Christian journey uttered from Jesus' lips, and from my flesh, I shall see God. Who's one to own? A gift for true friendship is one of the best markers of a solid friendship with God in Christ. He believed friendship was the enduring paradigm of our relationship with God. And he was most grateful in his life with friendship. Yet paradoxically, he once told me, it's not absolutely necessary to have friends, Andrew Carr, but most necessary to be a friend. And he was friends with so many of different faiths and traditions, of different socioeconomic levels, and different political persuasions. He was particularly a friend to the invisible people. We so often miss those behind the broom, sweeping our floors, tending to us when we're sick, driving us to appointments, standing behind a counter or a desk. Bruce befriended people we often walk by. He listened to their issues, and they informed his preaching and teaching. Bruce wrote about and discussed issues others would not. With the juggler, he once remarked, I simply have been a conservative when everyone was liberal, and liberal when everyone was conservative. But neither of those intellectually narrow categories embody Bruce Williams. Rather than simplistically conservative or liberal, I always found Bruce thoughtful. Something we have lost today in the life of our politics, and yes, even in our church. We live in an age of crisis regarding thoughtful discourse and critical reflection, and we just lost a man, a priest, who was an exemplar of both. One of his former students texted me this 2 nights ago. Such a good man, who impacted me greatly. Of all the Roman experiences, he was a gentleman in the midst of the intelligentsia, the Romanitas. He was pastoral. He helped point a way. Cherishing his Jewish roots, especially in his final years, Bruce would be as tickled today that his funeral is on Yom Kippur as he was in 2016 when the 8-day Hanukkah festival and the week-long Christmas celebration coincided with his advent. Bruce wrote these two sibling communities in the family of God will follow their own distinctive religious traditions. But the two festivals do share a common affirmation of the redeeming and renewing power of divine love. He further noted, this also entails rededicating ourselves to living to the full submission of God's will. Rededication is the literal meaning of Hanukkah. Christians draw this lesson from the mission of Christ, beginning with his birth. And that was Bruce's M.O. every day, to get up and to rededicate himself to the will of his living vindicator and preaching the friendship of Jesus Christ. I hope we rededicate ourselves to that as well. May his memory be a blessing. Shalom, shalom, Bruce. Shalom.
Thank you.
It's 3:30 Sunday morning, and I'm waiting for my Uber driver outside the hotel to take me back to BWI.